Hello everyone, I'm Joyee. I am a contributor to Node. Recently, we've been working on some new features in the Node module loaders, so I'd like to use this opportunity to introduce them to folks in the Vite ecosystem and get more feedback on how to improve them. Now, let's get started. The first one, which you may have heard about before, is that we have implemented ESN support in require. It's still under an experimental flag, --- experimental require module, and our plan is to unflag this in 23, get more battle testing before we backport this to LTS. So previously, if you have a ES module, like this hello.njs that we have here, and then you try to require it from a common JS module, like this index.cjs here, it will throw error require ESM. This has been a major source of frustration in the ecosystem and blocked a lot of package maintainers from either shipping ESM or supporting the users who want to use ESM. But now we have support for require ESM. After we unflag this feature, a common JS module will be able to load a ES module using require as long as the ES module is synchronous. And by being synchronous, I mean that the module doesn't contain any top level await. If it does, since require is synchronous, we cannot run the asynchronous away from it, and this will throw another error, the error require async module. But the vast majority of the ES modules out there don't actually use top level away anyway, so this error should be quite uncommon compared to the previous error that just forbids requiring any kind of ES module. You can still use top level away in an entry point or use import with it. It's just not supported when you try to require a module that does it. Sometimes the top level await might come from a dependency in your graph, so it can be difficult for you to find out where it is or how to fix it. For this, we have introduced another helper flag that runs the code, find out where that top level await is, and print it out for you. We expect to remove the experimental prefix of this flag in the future and maybe enable this by default when we figure out how to locate it without running the code. For now, on Node 22 with this --- experimental print require TLA flag, when you require an ES module that contains top level await, as you can see in the example here, it will print the location as well as the source code of the line that contains the await statement. Now, on the topic of top level await, one common use case of this that we found is that cross-platform code sometimes need to use it to detect whether the code is running on Node. Like here in the first example, it's trying to load OS built-in dynamically and do some tuning if that's available. With pure ES module syntax, you could only try to load a potentially non-existent module with the dynamic import call, which is asynchronous. That's why people had to use await at the top level to initialize their code. To fill this gap, we introduced process get built-in module. So ES modules can do this detection by just checking on global this and see if the function is there. If it is, then you can invoke this function to get the built-in. This returns synchronously, so you don't have to use await, and the module can then be required. This has been available on both 22 and 20. Another new feature that has been unflagged in 22 is module syntax detection in .js files. Previously, if you have an ES module in a file with the .js extension, like the esm.js here, and you don't use the type field in a package JSON to tell Node that it is an ES module, Node would try to parse it as common.js for backward compatibility, which wouldn't work because parsing the ES module syntax requires the runtime to tell the JavaScript engine it is ES module first. So when Node got this syntax error from the JavaScript engine, it used to just give up and ask users to be explicit about the module type, like setting type module in the package JSON or using the .njs extension. Since 22.7, when Node tries to parse a .js file as common.js and it doesn't work, and the syntax error indicates that it might be an ES module, Node will try to parse it again. For example, with a simple esm.js file using import here, when there isn't a package JSON around, or if its package JSON doesn't have a type field, Node would try to parse it again as an ES module, which would not fail, so Node would just accept that and load it as an ES module. This is meant to improve the user experience of executing simple scripts without a package JSON, but if you do have a package JSON, it's still recommended to add the type field because other tools or editors that you use may still rely on it for configuration. Also, the file will get parsed twice for the detection, and the result does not necessarily always match your expectation. So currently, if it hits this detection path when you do have a package JSON, and you could have specified a type field to save all this guesswork, Node will remind you with a warning. Another feature we recently added is module compile cache, which can be enabled with either the Node compile cache environment variable or the module enable compile cache JavaScript API. If you have used the VA compile cache libraries on npm, you can probably already tell that it is a built-in alternative to them. And the nice thing about it is that it supports ESM out of the box. After the module compile cache is enabled, when Node compiles a user module, if this module is loaded for the first time in the system and there isn't code cache for it on disk, Node will compile it from source, which is a bit slow, but the cache will be generated and returned to disk. So the next time the application is run, Node sees that there is already a cache, then it can read and visualize the bytecode, which is a lot faster than compiling the code from scratch. Some experiments in TypeScript has already shown that it can make TSC load more than twice as fast. So please give it a try if you're writing applications or tools that care about module loading time. So those were the features that we already released. Now let's talk about some other features that we have been working on. And by the time this video is recorded, they are still under review and are not yet released, but they should come out soon. And if you're interested, please check them out. Send us feedback or do some early experiments with them to help us make them mature. So one of the motivations of supporting required ESM was helping package authors ship native ESM. I took the data from a repository that has been surveying the module types of more than 5,000 high-impact NPM packages, and as you can see here, the migration to ESM has been going very slowly. Many package authors are choosing to ship both CommonJS and ESM to maximize compatibility, that is labeled dual here, or shipping transpiled CommonJS, that is labeled faux here. Shipping both ESM and CommonJS of the same package can lead to the so-called dual package hazard, where you end up with two versions of the same package in the graph that are conflicting with each other. So far, a common way to avoid this hazard is using the exports conditions. Like in this example, it is treating Node as an exception to use the CommonJS version, no matter it's required or imported, so that there won't be multiple versions of the same package in the graph. Now, with required ESM available, it will be possible for package authors to ship ESM for both import and require on newer versions of Node and avoid the hazard. But if it's not yet time for them to drop the support for older versions of Node, they will need a way to let Node only use the ESM version when it supports required ESM. For this, we are introducing a new exports condition for ESM, regardless of how it's loaded. We are looking into reusing the name module for this condition because it's already recognized by many bundlers such as Webpack and Rollup for a similar purpose. So this will help avoid further bloating your exports conditions. So here we have an example. On newer versions of Node, the module condition gets picked and Node will let both require and import get the ESM version of the package. On older versions of Node, where neither the module condition nor require is supported, Node will pick up the default export condition and always use the transpiled CommonJS version. When I made this video, we haven't yet finalized on the name of this condition, but I expect that we'll get it settled by October. When upgrading a CommonJS library to ESM, another issue package authors may run into is that in ES modules, the default exports are separate from the name exports. So if you have a CommonJS module that reassigns module.exports to something else, your CommonJS users are going to expect require to just return that thing. Now, if you upgrade it to ESM by using export default, your CommonJS users will have to get it by unwrapping the .default property of the return namespace because that's how ESM namespace works. You might be wondering, why can't Node just unwrap it for you? That's because if there are any additional name exports, they will get lost. This is not a problem if the module doesn't have default exports, but when they do, we need the hint from package authors to customize what required ESM should return. Now, when I'm recording this video, we haven't made up our mind yet, but so far, one of the nicer looking ideas is that package authors can export something as module.exports using a string name. The CommonJS users would just get what's exported as that directly, and they don't need to change their code after the package is upgraded to ESM, which would be pretty nice. This is still under discussion, and the module exports idea is just one of the options. But anyway, we'll probably settle it by October. Another feature we've been working on is synchronous module loader hooks. Now, we have already the module register, but those are run on a separate thread and have some limitations that can be challenging to work around. So we are working on a complementary API that fills this gap. This is meant to be synchronous, lightweight, and in-thread. So the new module loader hooks can mutate the main context and pass the functions around. It will be easier to debug, and it will work for all types of module loading APIs, no matter how the application is launched. There have been a lot of user code in the wild that are monkey patching the internals of a require or the internals of the module prototype, which has made the maintenance of the module loaders very difficult. But it is also very difficult for them to migrate to the module register API because they have very different execution models. So with this new hook API that provides a more similar execution model, will hopefully allow them to migrate to a more public API and allow us to maintain the node module loader better. And because this is not CommonJS specific, this might also allow them to support ESM out of the box. The rough sketch of the new API basically looks like this. It's still similar to module register, but it will be all synchronous since we need to run them directly from require. And this API will just accept functions directly. So let's say to port the example of the pirates package on npm, you can implement a load hook, invoke the default loading step synchronously using the last argument, next load, then modify the source code a bit if the extension matches a pattern. This API will also unblock future hooks for mutating the results of require directly, since it's now on the same thread. This is what the require in the middle npm package currently does with monkey patching. It can also unblock more granular customization of ESM needed by other packages. So far, we have settled down on some of the key design questions, and we'll probably have an experimental implementation coming out soon. The last thing I want to introduce, and this is a pretty ambitious project, is support for Node runtime configuration files that can be automatically loaded. So sometimes a tool may want their users to preload some of their code to prepare the environment before any other user code is run. You could tell the users to use the --import or --require command line flags, but users will also need to make sure to pass them down into their own workers or child processes. Sometimes users might want to pass additional node flags to a process launched by another executable, which already takes control of the flags. They could use the node options environment variable, but then it can get lost if the third-party code overrides this when spawning a child worker or process. And overall, the user experience would be nicer if these configurations can be specified with a file and edited by tools. So we're currently designing a way for users to specify node runtime configurations in a file. So far, the general idea is in package.json, you can specify a node RC field that points to another JSON configuration. The schema of this configuration is controlled by node, and it is versioned by breaking changes. When a node process is launched from the directory that contains these files, it will automatically discover these configurations and, for example, preload some code to set up telemetry and make sure that all the child workers can inherit these configurations. This also allows, for example, loading the environment variable from a local file without having to use the --m file command line flag. We also have other ideas, such as allowing some kind of structural representation of the flags or allowing extends or overrides of another configuration file. But anyway, these are all very early drafts, and I expect that we'll iterate quite a bit on this before it gets implemented and released. It would be great though to get more input from people who have experience with runtime configurations or people who have been trying to get this done properly, either for their own code or for their users' code. So that's a summary for the new stuff we've been working on in Node modulators. Thanks for staying with me, and I hope to see you all on GitHub.